The past is another country. 1987's just the Isle of Wight. I love that line. Welcome to the Cloister Bell podcast, where in this episode we talk about my favourite Christopher Eccleston story, Father's Day.
The TARDIS Cloister Bell. Imminent disaster.
The Cloister Bell?
Yes.
What's that?
Well, it's a sort of communications device reserved for wild catastrophes and sudden calls to man the battle stations.
That's the Cloister Bell. Don't worry about that for now. It's not really terribly significant.
The Cloister Bell? Oh, no.
Hi, everyone, and welcome back. This is the Cloister Bell podcast. I'm Liam, and I'm joined by Rob. Hi, Rob.
Hello, Liam.
And how's it going?
Not bad. I'm on my second week off work, so enjoying the sun, enjoying the rain. I'm a bit bored at home. I don't want to go back to work, and I don't want to stay at home, so I just kind of want to, you know what, when you just, I just like when I'm sat in the car, and I just...
Yeah, I just want to go out and head places.
Just hide.
Yeah. Yeah, I get that. It's the weather's been a bit, typically British, I suppose. It's been absolutely fantastically, wonderfully summery.
It was boiling this morning.
It was, yeah, it was amazing this morning. And then all of a sudden, the grey, doom-laden clouds approached and started buckling it down for a short while. And it just, where the hell have these rain clouds come from?
Yeah. Like this morning, I was just out walking in my t-shirt. Mm. Then this afternoon, I was at Silverlink Retail Park with the family. And I had to go and get the car to go pick them up from one of the shops. It's that bad.
Yeah.
And then this evening, been sat out in the garden. It's been fine. It's like it never happened. Rain.
Yeah. Thankfully, I was in the office when it was raining. But, you could... It's just, you know, nice and sunny. The windows were flung open, just enjoying it. Everyone in a happy mood. Then it started raining. Then it got depressed. It was suddenly cold. Then walked home, and this, you know, it was. And then when I was walking home, the weather had massively improved, which was nice.
Yeah.
So once again, we'll be talking about the weather. Anything else?
No, just. Yeah, just the weather that's happened today, pretty much. Yeah. That's it.
I'm still been going through, because even though there's only four adventures, I've still been going through the Season 24 Blu-ray box set, because it's just jam-packed with stuff. And I finished watching Delta and the Bannerman the other day, which is not one of my favourite stories. I like the idea behind it, and there's a lot of potential, and there's some nice scenes in there, but overall the show doesn't do anything for me. And then the thing is, it's not only do you have the televised adventures, but you also have extended cuts of all the stories as well, which is great. You know,
Of each one,
yeah. So, you know, enjoying the extended cut of Time and the Ronnie and Paradise Towers, but it's just like, do I really need an extended cut of Delta and the Bannerman? But you never know, the extended cut may actually be better. I mean, I doubt it, but I'm having to
You're just tempted to watch the shorter version.
I've watched the shorter version. I think I'm done with it. I have to work sort of psych myself up to watch the extended version of Delta and the Bannerman. I'll give it a couple of months and I might finally get around to that. But it has been fun going through Season 24.
That's great. Yeah.
And in fact, you put up a Twitter recently which got a huge response, which was... Well, actually, do you want to talk about that?
Sure, I just casually asked, who was the Doctor on the year you were born? If there was no Doctor that year, who was the most recent Doctor? Mm-hmm. And it turned into a bit of a gift party.
Yeah, it did. But it also trended quite highly. It was one of the most talked about Doctor Who tweets going. But it was quite nice. There was a huge response of people just reminiscing about their earliest memories and so on.
Yeah, it was a surprise to me because I actually did it because there's a lot of younger people on Twitter that are younger than us, in fact, that who were born after the new series started, which seems so bizarre. These people are growing up now. Yeah. So I was curious to see, would it be more of the old or more of the new? Mm. And it was quite nice to see there's a lot of older people on there. In fact, there's a lot of people that said that the show hadn't even started when they were born.
Yes, I saw a couple of those, which was quite impressive. So they were just like, well, my earliest Doctor is whatever. It's obviously Hartnell, but...
Pre-Hartnell.
Yeah, pre-Hartnell. So, you know, take your pick if you want to go down the childish. The childish. The timeless child route.
Let's not be childish.
No, of course not. Although we do have something to talk about in relation to that. But yeah, that was quite nice to have the huge response. Then I was born 5 months after Colin Baker's final episode with the Trial of a Time Lord and 4 months before Time and the Rani. So I'm close to my McCoy, but I'm almost sort of halfway between the two. But you were born a month before McCoy, weren't you?
Yes, I was born in the August, and was that the back end of September?
I think...
When he started?
I think it was actually the beginning. I've got the 7th of September stuck in my head. Hang on, I'll do a quick Google.
While you're doing that, there was a lot of people unsure. Maybe I didn't specify what qualifies as the Doctor the year you were born or closest, because a lot of people... was saying, we're rounding it up and saying, well, maybe like Eccleston's my doctor because I was born in 2004, for example. Which is, I kept saying that's fair enough, yeah.
Yeah, episode 1 of Time and the Rani, 7th of September 1987.
Yeah. It was nice to see a lot of people were saying, like, Richard E. Grant, Joanna Lumley.
Oh, yes, yeah.
Peter Cushion.
That was great. It was just nice to see an awful lot of people just reminiscing. It was quite nice. But, there's been rumours floating around for quite some time that Jodie Whittaker and Chris Chibnall would be leaving the show, and that was just denied. But quite recently, that has actually, it's finally been announced. Jodie Whittaker and Chris Chibnall will be leaving the show. Which has obviously got an awful lot of... Sorry, what did you say?
Well, the perception is, especially in the media, that she's quit.
Hmm.
But in actuality, we've got her for 2 more series. We've got her for this short run of, what is it, 8-episode series?
Yeah.
And then we've got a series of specials next year.
Hmm.
Which is technically like 2 box sets, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so she's going to be around for a while.
But it's, I think everyone, it was, I think people were perhaps expecting them to hang around a little bit longer. I've got a group of friends, I'll just leave it up there and surprise everyone. I've got a group of mates. None of whom
You've got friends?
I've got friends, friggin' hell. Who knew? And none of them are into Doctor Who. But even people who aren't into it, when Doctor Who's in the news, it hits big and everyone's sort of aware of it. And they were aware that Jodie Whittaker and Chris Chibnall would be leaving. And we were having a conversation, and they mentioned, oh, isn't it a black actress who's going to be the next Doctor? Well, we don't know. What they've said is they want a... and I'm quoting here, this is what the BBC have said, that they want a person of colour to play the Doctor. And not that it matters, but I thought their response to when I said that, keeping in mind that, again, not that it should matter, but these group of friends, none of them are Caucasian, they're not white, they went, what? They actually said that. I went, yeah, they want a person of colour to play the Doctor. And they went, okay. Their whole thing was that's a really bizarre response, because it's sort of like you've got someone to play the role and they just went, yeah, yeah, it's all good. They're not white and they can also act. And they just thought it was to actually go down that route of, you know, clearly sort of like what they said was just like, it seems like it would be a tick box exercise rather than casting an actor who happens to be non-white, who would be good in the role, rather than it's sort of they're looking at the skin colour as a, you know, as the main criteria before looking at anything else. So the reaction was one of they weren't happy with that. They thought it was a very odd way of going about of casting a main role. I suspect a lot of people would agree.
That's the way I'd perceive that. I quite often defend things when people say, oh, they're just trying to tick a box because we've got a female doctor, and they'll do it again. And it's like, well, they can't really win next time, you know. There's always going to be 50% of the people saying that. But yes, to come out and say, okay, we're going to cast someone of colour, yeah, you're right, that is I mean, the intention is of course a positive one, but it should come down to the person in particular.
Yeah, and of course,
try and be as diverse as you can in the casting process.
Mm-hmm. But then you could actually say that we already have, we already have a black actress who's played the Doctor.
Yeah, we've had two.
Who's the second? Oh, yes, you're right. Yeah, yeah. Sorry, the Timeless Child.
The first Doctor. Yes, the very first.
So we've had all that, but we have. Oh, sorry, Rob. Her name eludes me. Something Martin. The actress. What's her name?
The Ruth Doctor.
Yes, the Ruth Doctor.
Joe Martin.
Joe Martin. Thank you. Sorry, her name slipped my mind. Yes, so Joe Martin. If that's what you want to do, is that, well, we've already got an actress who's, why don't we follow her adventures? We could do that. Because she's fantastic.
Yeah, and she's kind of come in the back door and she's already established.
Mm-hmm.
And, yeah. And that would be interesting. I mean, it could happen.
Yeah, yeah, it could. And it would be, because one idea that I've had for ages, just those things of, what would you do if you were running the show? And I thought, well, wouldn't it be interesting if we had a doctor who met a future version of themselves, then regenerates, and it's actually their immediate successor. Mm. You know, you could do something interesting with that. And the show could easily do that, because I think a lot of people, and I think certainly include ourselves, we love the Ruth Doctor. It was just it was a huge surprise, and
it was also a bit of a confusing one, because not all the answers were given. And for us who are aware of what's been established, it raised a lot of questions, like, hang on, if she is a pre-Hartnell Doctor, why does she have a police box?
Yes, yeah.
Why does she have all these hallmarks of the Doctor that weren't established until later on in the show?
Yeah, and then, but really what you're initially responding to, I mean, there was a lot to consider with that, but really what you're initially responding to is the actor or the actress playing the role. And Joe Martin did a fantastic job and was very engaging and very exciting and interesting. And you would go, to the point where, in some respects, sort of overshadowed Jodie Whittaker. And you go, I kind of want to know more about the Ruth Doctor and see her adventures.
She must be back, especially if Chibnall's wrapping everything up.
Mm-hmm.
And there's more to explain about the past.
Yeah, but going back to that initial news that they're going to be leaving, you know, after this season and with the three specials. Actually, it's going to be the 60th anniversary year where we will potentially see a new Doctor and new showrunner.
Or potentially nothing.
Or potentially nothing, yeah, as you say, that's the thing. But hopefully, it would be nice to get some Doctor Who in the 60th year. I think it's, you know, people are obviously doing a quick reflection of, right, well, how well has this run gone? And obviously I'm not wishing to put words into your mouth. Obviously you can respond back. But I think it would be safe to say that we both agree that we would say it hasn't been great.
No. And I think the formula was great of... having a clean slate, mm-hmm. new doctor, new companions. I think I didn't really want, I felt like I didn't need many links to the past. Mm-hmm. But I think had the storytelling been better,
yeah,
that would have helped.
Yeah, and I think that really comes down to it. It's, I think it's safe to say for me, obviously. We love the show, and you know, we recognise that there are great stories in the series, and there's some really, you know, right duff ones, but you know, you take the rough with the smooth and you just enjoy the show. And in terms of going, well, what's your favourite era, what's your least favourite, it's been quite difficult until now. I can quite clearly say that, well, my least favourite era is Jodie Whittaker's time as the Doctor. The problem is nothing to do with her. She's very good. I like her as an actress. I liked her performance as the Doctor. I liked the rest of the TARDIS crew in terms of the characters, such as they were, and mainly the actors. I think this era of the show had a very good cast. Where it falls down is with the storytelling. And we've had some very talented writers write for the show. But I think it's been perfectly clear that a lot of the problems stem from Chris Chibnall's direction of the show. And I said this in an earlier podcast. It's really odd that I... See, because this period of the show has elicited a lot of raw emotion. Some people just absolutely raving about the series and how much they love it, which is great. It's nice to get that positive feedback, although I don't understand why, you know, me personally, with my taste, I don't see how anyone could, you know, love the show, you know, so hugely, but it's nice to see. And then some people just absolutely hating it. But again, I don't see how it can elicit that such a huge response, because this era of the show has just left me feeling indifferent and just go, I think it's okay at best. Which is odd, considering the fact that it's had some huge surprises and some very good ideas. You know, the way that the Cybermen had been used, I think, was very, very good. The way that the Master was brought back, that was a huge surprise for one thing. The way that
yeah, so series 12 was an improvement in some ways over the first.
Yes,
you know, maybe it'll get a lot better.
Hopefully. I mean, it would be nice at least to see Jodie Whittaker going out on a high and hopefully coming out with some excellent stories. I mean, she deserves it. But up until now, it's really... It's a shame with Jodie Whittaker, because I would have liked to have seen her have better material. I'm not sad to see Chris Chibnall leave.
No.
But you were saying that we've received some feedback in relation to that, is that right?
Yes, because of course we've had the news that she'll be leaving and so will Chris Chibnall, but there's also been a teaser trailer as well.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't reveal that much, but nonetheless it's a load of new clips. So a few people have got in touch to let us know their thoughts on all this news. David from Neither the Time Nor Space podcast said, keeping my fingers crossed that they'll be bowing out on a high note with series 13 and the specials. I really wanted Whittaker to book the 3-series trend, but alas, that being said, change is exciting. I have no specific hopes for a new showrunner and 14th Doctor, other than different.
Mm-hmm.
He's right to mention that that 3-series trend, which seems to be the max for everybody.
Yeah, it does.
It seemed like a short run for Whittaker because we've had so many gaps.
That's the other thing as well. And these gaps, I mean, those gaps were there before the, the government restrictions in relation to COVID kicked in. So that was always a part of the, you know, the huge gaps. You know, there was a gap with her first, you know, before we got to her first series. Then when that ended, there was a gap between, you know.
It was a full year. I think it was one New Year's Day to the following New Year's Day between Resolution and Spyfall Part 1.
Yeah, and that's another thing as well. When we get to the new showrunner, we need... the problem is with that approach is just you're letting the momentum go.
Yeah.
And... people's interest just, you know, will dissipate. I mean, the thing is that this, you know, the show's been going on for quite a long time. You know, you need to keep up people's interest.
Especially with it only being her first series and then having such a large gap.
Yeah.
Like, if it was a doctor that everyone was familiar with, say Tennant did a few series and then had a gap year. I think it would still be a success because everyone is so familiar.
Yes, well, wasn't that the case with Peter Capaldi? Wasn't there a gap between his penultimate and his final season or something? I'm sure there was a gap somewhere.
I don't quite remember.
Yeah, it feels like that was a lifetime ago. But I'm sure there was a gap somewhere with the Capaldi era, if memory serves.
Yeah.
And you're right, it works because he was an established doctor and that was fine. Establishing a new doctor, it was a big mistake, and the world moves on. And especially because, really, you're in competition with other shows, which people can binge watch. Although I think that viewing habit is altering a bit. I don't think people still binge watch, of course, but I don't think to the same extent. You can still have... Yeah. A TV series on a weekly rotating basis, and people will still be interested in it. But when the show does come back with a new showrunner, you need that just continuous momentum. Have it come back
every
year.
Keep the momentum going until it's well established.
Mm-hmm.
Christopher Brett Hall said, "It's a shame, but I never felt Chibnall really found his footing as showrunner, and Whittaker never seemed as good a story." Sorry. And Whittaker never seemed to get a story which really showed what she could do with the role.
Mm-hmm.
Your Cool 91 said, "I'm hoping that the serialized structure of the next season will play more to Chibnall's strengths, because it's been revealed that the next series will be one continuous story,
mm-hmm.
interconnected. And let him go out on a high note after a fairly controversial time as showrunner. I can't say I'm sorry to see him go, though, since the last two seasons haven't really been to my taste. I'm annoyed that Jodie hasn't had a chance to really get a standalone episode. Honestly, my only desire for the next Doctor is that they're either a woman or a POC? Person of colour, is that right?
Yes. Yes, yeah.
If we go back to white guys, the idea will cement that 13 was a failed experiment and the NMD side of the fandom." Yes, it would be unfortunate if people perceive it that, okay, they've had a shot at getting a woman doctor. It hasn't worked, let's move on. And because Jodie Whittaker, she's quite unique, and she's quirky, and if you cast another woman, it's going to be completely different.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because do you agree with that? Jodie's quite unique.
Yeah, I would say so. I mean, she's unique already in that, you know, she's the first woman doctor. But yeah, in terms of she's very bubbly.
The personality and, yeah.
Yeah.
And I think anyone else, it would add... a completely different dynamic.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm all for getting more female doctors, just so we can see different performances and different takes on that.
Yeah, and I agree with that. I think if we were to get a male doctor again, immediately after Jodie Whittaker. I mean, you never know. Obviously, it depends at the end of the day on who they get to play the part. But I think it would have that thing of going, oh, well, look, we tried it with a woman and it failed. I think it would benefit the show if they immediately followed it up with another woman playing the part. But really, at the end of the day, I'm not that fussed by it. It's if it's a man, if it's whatever, obviously as long as they're good.
Yeah.
But nonetheless, I can see that point. And you don't want to see it as a failure, because really, the failure of this era, it's got nothing to do with Jodie Whittaker. I think everyone, the vast majority of people, and we certainly agree that she was a good choice. But it's like that thing of just going, wasted potential. And actually, that's not just with her. That was with the other companions. They weren't really... The actors themselves were brilliant. Where it failed was the writing. They didn't really develop, or there were certain character traits which were established but they never really picked up on. You know, just things like that. Mm.
Maybe the busy TARDIS formula doesn't always work.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, too many characters. Gareth Alexander said, not necessarily for Jodie, but definitely for Chibbers, with regards to leaving.
Mm-hmm.
So, I think that's a view I share.
I think most people do, actually, yeah.
The Time Lush said, delighted. Yeah, happy to see them go.
Yeah. I think everyone's just very eager just to get a new, fresh look at the show. And actually, I think when it comes to Chris Chibnall, him appearing on Open Air, that clip that we have as part of the Liverpool Doctor Who Appreciation Society, criticising the Trial of a Time Lord, I think will always come back to haunt him. Because, you know, we like stories like Rosa, and we like things like Witchfinders, and there are a couple of other episodes, but taken as a whole, I think the Trial of a Time Lord beats the whole Chris Chibnall. You know, I would much rather watch the Trial of a Time Lord than sit through a Chris Chibnall run series. It just sort of,
I totally agree with that.
Mm.
Yeah. Yeah, if I had to binge one in a day, yeah.
Which one do I pick? Do I pick a season that Chris Chibnall was in charge of, or the Trial of a Time Lord? Trial of a Time Lord wins all the time. And then again with the recent trailer, I do appreciate that it's just a teaser trailer. It's not the full thing. It's just there to whet the appetite. Even then, I don't think it works. I watched it and I couldn't get excited by it. And it's like what I've said before with this, because I'm really not that fussed about the current run of Doctor Who. If it wasn't for doing this podcast, I don't think I'd be watching it.
Yeah.
You know. What were your thoughts on the trailer?
On the trailer, I was intrigued and I just kind of zoned out. I give it one watch, which is unusual for a Doctor Who trailer.
Mm-hmm.
I gave it one watch and I thought, well, there's nothing really to dissect here. Other people online will probably do a breakdown and nothing of interest kind of popped up. Usually there is something intriguing or like a little reveal.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it is what it is, but we're used to seeing more, I think. That's the problem.
Nah, perhaps, yeah, maybe we have been spoiled. And that's the thing as well, maybe you go, oh, you're not happy, because we've complained in the past with previous trailers for the show where they've given too much away.
We're just never happy.
Yeah, we're just never happy. Of course we're not. We're Doctor Who fans. We've always got something to moan and bitch about. But actually, on positive news, just to go back to the positive. So our friends at Who Can Convince You podcast recently did a special, very long podcast, 3 hours, where it was, because it was an epic, where they asked other podcasters what they would like to do if they were in charge of the show, and a couple of other questions. Firstly, if they're listening, I just want to thank them. You know, just thank you so much for including our response, because everyone else, or the vast majority, provided audio clips. Unfortunately, we just didn't have the time to do that. But we managed to although strangely, I managed to find time to bash out an essay, which they read in its entirety, which I was incredibly impressed with. And really, that's what I want to thank them for. Thank you so much for reading my mini essay on what I would do if I was in charge of the show.
Go and check that out. Yeah,
yeah.
We'll not give them the timestamp. They have to like sit through the whole thing.
Oh yeah, yeah. Well, yeah, no, please do, because there are loads of other, you know, people who contribute, and they have some really nice, interesting things to say as well.
But yeah, that's Harry and Luke over at the Who Can Convince You podcast.
Yeah, yeah.
And go and check that out. They did put a video recently on Twitter, and they've got a big vinyl sticker on their van for the podcast.
Yes, yeah, yeah. Certainly pays to advertise. Yeah, if you haven't listened to them, I would recommend it, because it's just great fun to listen to, and they've got a great rapport, and it's an awful lot of fun. And the format's quite good as well, because they discuss two Doctor Who stories, usually from completely different periods in one podcast. So yeah, it's very good.
I don't know if you were familiar with the name, because I don't really have time to listen to many podcasts, because I'm either too busy working, sleeping, or prepping for this podcast.
Yes.
So I do kind of dive into them. I try to get to know them all. And these guys, I did actually listen to a fair few of the podcasts months ago, so I was actually quite familiar with them.
Right, okay, good.
I was skipping through them, so it was quite... it was good. It was quite good checking them out again. But yeah, they're definitely on my listen list for... on a weekly basis now, as long as they don't bring out 3.5-hour podcasts every week.
Other good Doctor Who podcasts are, of course, available. Yes. But no, Ed, yeah, thank you very much for including our contribution and reading my whole damn response. I could have edited that down, but that was impressive.
Also, the My Adventure in Space and Time podcast recently revisited the Aztecs. Well, they actually made a comparison to the Aztecs in Father's Day in that, with regards to wanting to change time.
Ah, right, okay, interesting.
But they were kind enough to share our Aztecs game from the website.
Oh, right, okay, excellent.
on their social media. So thank you for that, that was nice. Mm-hmm. But make sure to check them out also. They've recently started exploring Doctor Who from the very beginning. It's Shona, who's occasionally joined by Carolyn and other guests now. And they began that back in April, of course, starting with An Unearthly Child.
Oh, yes. Because they also contributed to the Who Can Convince You podcast. I remember that, and I'm thinking that... Yes, because I remember thinking, oh, because I wasn't aware of them, and I was just thinking... That podcast sounds interesting, so I'll be giving them a listen. Yeah.
I've been listening to them for a little while, so yeah, check them out also. Yeah.
But still listen to us.
Yeah.
Oh, just recommending better podcasts to other people, it's not a good business model. Anyway, without further ado, let's crack on. So first of all, just our social media information, so you can get in contact with us via Twitter at Podcast Bell. That's where the vast majority of people respond to us, and that's probably the best place. Instagram, we're also on Cloister_Bell. Our website, cloisterbellpodcast.com, where you can also obviously access the podcast, but we also have some nice games that Rob has done with word searches and a few other things. Check those out. And you can, if you like this podcast, you can support us in, you know, getting the word out there, sharing, which we appreciate. And if you'd like to go perhaps that little step further, you can also support us via Patreon. Link is on our website, which again is cloisterbellpodcast.com, but you can also search for us on Patreon. Right, so over to Father's Day. So the quick plot synopsis is Rose travels back to 1987 to witness the day her father died, but when she interferes in the course of events, saving his life, the monstrous reapers, monsters who devour everyone to correct time paradoxes, are unleashed upon the world. So the cast and crew, Christopher Eccleston plays the Doctor, Billy Piper plays Rose Tyler, Camille Cordero plays Jackie Tyler, Sean Dingwall plays Peter Tyler, Robert Barton plays the Registrar, Julia Joyce plays the young Rose Tyler, Christopher Lewin plays Stuart Hoskins, Frank Rosila Green plays Sonny Hoskins, Natalie Jones plays Sarah Clark, Erilis Bellum plays Bev, Ryan James plays Susie, and Casey Dyer plays the young Mickey. The story was written by Paul Cornell, it was directed by John O'Hearn, it was produced by Phil Collinson, the music was by Murray Gold, the costume design was by Lucinda Wright, and the production design by Edward Thomas. So we discussed Dalek in our previous podcast, which was Rob's favourite Eccleston adventure, and the reason why we're discussing Father's Day is because this is my favourite Eccleston adventure. And for me, I think this perfectly encapsulates Russell T. Davies' approach to the show. Yes, I know Phil. I was going to say Phil Collinson. I know Paul Cornell wrote the story itself, but you know, RTD's in charge of the show. And the reason why I say that is because this is, I think, is a very good blend of the emotional connection that people can have with the science fiction. So the episode begins with the establishment that Rose's father died in a car crash when she was just a baby. She never knew her father, and she's explaining this with the doctor, and then says could she go back and see him, but specifically when he died, because her mother always said that he died alone, and Rose doesn't want that. She wants to, you know, comfort him, at least be there when he died. And the doctor complies with this. It's just like, yep, no problem, I can't see any problems with that. And then they arrive there. This is November, the story's set in November 1987.
For us.
Yeah, very, very much so. I mean, I don't remember it, but very important year. It was the year we were born. But so this is a period drama, and so just in terms of its setting of having the story set in 1987, what are your thoughts on that, Rob?
About the setting of the year.
Mm-hmm. And how it comes across.
I don't know if there's any inaccuracies, if that's what you're getting at. But, yeah, it kind of comes across. It reminds me of all the weird hairdos of the early 90s. But maybe there could have been more of that. And the old cars. But, yeah, it does kind of feel... like it was a long time ago. What do you mean, though?
No, I was just wondering if you thought that the way that they established that this is set in 1987, did you think it was effective?
Yes, especially. Well, I related to the age of Rose because it was our age. It kind of made sense. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And it does it very in a very. Very, I don't mean this in a derogatory sense. It does it in a very cheap way, where you know, it's just set in a, you know, it's filmed in a normal location, and all what we're doing is we're just panning across a street, and we have these posters up telling us, you know, Thatcher not to have another third election.
So you think maybe that could have been done a lot better to establish the time?
Yeah, maybe a little bit. I mean, because, you know, I'm a bit of a nerd with these sort of things because, you know, I'm into politics. But it was sort of, those posters are already out of date because that year's election was in June the 11th, 1987. And this story's set in November. And we've still got and that was with Thatcher winning her third term. So these posters are already out of date. They should have been ripped down months ago.
Well, that's fine. As long as they're not up before, they should be up.
That's true. The funny thing is, up in Newcastle, it might be in other places as well, even now, you still walk around and you still got these stickers on lampposts telling us, you know, it's time for change, vote for Corbyn 2019.
Okay, we'll get around to that.
Yeah, we'll get around to that. Yeah. There's plenty of time. Yeah, so it's just, I mean, not that there's anything wrong with it. It establishes 1987. It does its job. But I mean, I suppose I'm just being ridiculously overcritical. I was just wondering if they could have. But then, you know, how would they done it? Like, just people walking around like Michael Jackson and with ridiculous perms or something like that.
Yeah, that would have worked.
Yeah, that would have worked. And actually, you know, later on, as you said, with car models and costumes and hair and everything like that, it it works.
The odd reference to Betamax things.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, so, you know, you get all that. So it does it effectively. And we're thrown straight into time paradoxes straight away, because the Rose and the Doctor there witness Rose's father die, and Rose can't comfort him. She's too much in shock.
No, I was actually surprised that the Doctor actually let her go through with this. Like, maybe it would have been too traumatic.
Yeah, I mean, he does actually ask, are you sure about this?
Mm-hmm.
And he can clearly understands the reason behind it.
I'm surprised he doesn't get this a lot. Because I feel like in reality, people do bring this up. You know, if you had a time machine, what would you go back and change?
Mm.
And this is where I get really annoyed, because I bring up... Well, you can't really bring up the rules of time travel without... I haven't done it myself. But, you know, I bring up cause and effect, and that just spirals off into different timelines. And you can't go back and magically change an event and have the present as it was, but magically different.
My brain hurts, Rob. What? No, I get it. And that's what, it's one of the reasons why that, on the whole, there are exceptions like the Stephen Moffat era, but on the whole, the reason why a show which involves time travel doesn't go down the route of time paradoxes. It's too much. It's too complicated. It can be fun to do. I think Day of the Daleks does that very effectively, and it's sort of it does it in the way that the first Terminator film does it. You know, that sort of way. It plays with the idea, but in a very fun way. You know,
yeah.
It's sort of like, you know, in the second Austin Powers movie.
Yes.
And there's that, you know, he's got a time traveling car, and then Basil Exposition is telling him about, you know, how time travel works, and then Austin says, "But if I do this and do the da 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 da," and he goes, "Oh no, I've gone cross-eyed." And then Basil Exposition says, "I wouldn't worry about it, Austin. Just have a good time." And then Austin Powers turns to us, the audience, and goes, "Yes, and you have a good time too." It's just like, yeah, don't think about it. It's time paradox. It's fun, but don't dwell on it too much. It's I think that is probably the best approach to take in general.
I feel like we do well to do that with Doctor Who. I think any other show or movie, I'd nitpick the time travel, but don't even bother with Doctor Who.
Don't even bother. The TARDIS there, it's a great idea, but it's there just to get you to the story, which is, you know, any time, any place, let's do whatever. Because as we know, Doctor Who has this incredibly flexible format. You can do anything with it, and that's the strength of the show. And yeah. So just go with it.
And then something will not be referenced, or something will be retconned, or something will contradict something.
Mm.
And we're like, just go with it, it's Doctor Who. That's normal.
Yeah, that's normal.
That's meant to happen.
Yeah. Certainly at this stage, if you're attempting to try and get everything to tie up and make sense and all the rest of it, you're on a losing battle, and you'll go stir-fry crazy. Just don't bother with it. But I suppose it works when you're exploring it just in a story, and you do it in a way such as, I think, Father's Day does it. Because I think the skill lies in, if you're going to do a story that deals with mucking about with time, but you're able to do it in a comprehensive way, that's where the skill lies. Anyone can make these ideas complicated. That's easy. Presenting them in a very palatable way, which allows you, the audience, to easily follow it. That's where the skill lies. And I think Father's Day does it, you know, very well.
Yeah, there's a few elements to the story which could have been a bit hard to understand if it hadn't been pulled off properly near the end. But it does kind of work, and it's, you understand what's going on and what needs to be done.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it was pulled off really well.
Yeah. And in fact, because it's there at the very beginning. So when the Doctor and Rose are initially watching Pete die, and Rose was supposed to, you know, go over to him to comfort him in his dying moments, and she can't because she's in too much shock. So they give it one more go. But their previous selves are still there. And, you know, and the Doctor's explaining that this is the last chance that we can do it, and we can't bump into them. You run to your father when you run off initially and all the rest of it. You, the audience, get what he's talking about and the reason why. It doesn't have to be spelt out so much. I think that's handled really well. And of course, when then Rose then just decides, well, actually, she's going to just save him anyway, and then she does that, and then the earlier versions of themselves disappear. You follow it through. You know, you get the fact that this is affecting time. One thing that I want to ask is, because the Doctor picks up on this point later on. This is when she saved her father. The father's still alive. He then references Rose, so the very first episode of the new series, and says, look, when I said, do you want to come with me, you refused. And then I mentioned Time Machine, and then you got interested, and then that's when you joined me.
I don't buy that from Rose's perspective in the moment of Rose. I don't think, okay, I'm going to exploit this to save my dad. Do you think that's not the case?
No, I totally agree with you. When you're watching Rose, it feels like it's a split moment. It says, you know, do you want to come with? Or did I mention it also travels in time? What? Hell yeah, this is more interesting. And she just, you know, runs to it, and it's a great end to the episode.
But the way that she's kind of apprehensive to bring it up, and bring it up the right way when she asks the Doctor at the beginning of this episode, it's obviously been on her mind for a while, and maybe she's been waiting for the right moment.
Yeah, I mean, but in terms of the drama, it makes sense. It makes sense why the Doctor would question that, and I think I do think it's an interesting moment. And maybe Rose didn't think of it initially, at the beginning when he mentions the time machine, but maybe the idea has been sort of festering and building up during the course of the adventures. So it's an interesting question to pose. And as you say, Rose is sort of wanting to divert very, you know, quickly that line of thought. So I think it's really up to you, the audience, because the way that it plays out, but also the way that it's written, I think is quite clever. And it's really up to you, the audience, to go, well, was it a spur of the moment thing that Rose just decided to do it, or has this been something that's been on her mind for some time?
Yeah. Do you think it would be on everyone's minds? Maybe all of the companions have had this thought at some point, something they want to go about and change. Because it's kind of it's a one-off kind of thing, isn't it?
It is, yeah. I mean, it's possibly. I mean,
I'm sure we all would. I mean, I'm sure there's bigger existential things we'd all want to like explore, like God and religion and the origin of life and things like that. We'd all be like, do we want to go down that route?
I think that would... I mean, if you had the opportunity to time travel, you would go, well, hang on.
Can I ask some of the ultimate questions here?
Yeah, hang on. I've got an opportunity to go back and see if such and such a thing did happen. But I think initially you would want to... I think probably... Because my great-grandfather passed away when I was 8, but I still remember him and I still miss him. You know, I loved him dearly. And if I'd had the opportunity to time travel, I'd go, you know what, I'd love to go back and see him.
And it's interesting, Rose says when she goes back, she says, oh, I thought it would be all all dark and cloudy, but it's just a normal day.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So if we did have the opportunity to go back, yeah, maybe our memories aren't quite what we think.
Yeah. Well, it's not necessarily the sense of her memory, because this happened when she was a baby, but obviously the way that it's being played in the mind again, you know, you're talking about the death of your father, and you know, and she was told this when she was a child. So the imagination fills in the gaps, and you would think, well, this was a tragic occurrence, and so everything about the day would reflect that. But of course, that's not what life is, and it's just a normal day. It's not dark clouds or anything. But again, that's a nice human touch, an emotional moment, of which this episode has loads of those.
Yeah, and her perception of him is not quite what the reality is, because she says, "Oh, I imagined him taller," and of course they go in there, they go and see the wedding,
mm-hmm.
And she learns how he's a bit of a failure.
Mm-hmm. Like, well, compared to sort of like Dale Boy, the character in Only Fools and Horses, sort of compares him to you're like a bit of a Dale Boy figure, because obviously her mother romanticized, you know, because she loved him. And she sort of romanticized it and didn't want to focus on the negatives. So it was sort of put across that, oh, he was a brilliant businessman. But, you know, he wasn't. He was just someone who was trying to make ends meet. But although, interestingly, you know, he did have he clearly had an imagination. You know, we see it. He drew up plans for solar panels and things like that. But at the end of the day, you know, he was just a normal bloke trying to make ends meet. One of the best scenes in this, for me, is it's immediate. You know, they're in the flat, and Rose knows that, you know, the doctor's not happy, and she's going, "Well, look, we save people's lives all the time. You do. What's the difference here? It's not as it's not as if he's important. It's not as if he's going to become president or start World War III or whatever." And I really like the doctor's response, which is, you know, he's an ordinary person, and there's nothing more special than that. You know, he's an ordinary person, a wonderful person who was dead and now isn't. That is going to have an effect, which I just thought was really nice and. Superb writing. And again, that this goes into I think that again, I know that this was written by Paul Cornell, and he's done you know, he did a superb job here, but this, I think, again encapsulates what Russell T. Davis's ethos was for the show. You know, how he wanted to tell these big stories, but telling them in a way which, you know, allows but telling them in a way where we, the audience, can easily connect and emote to. And I think this is probably one of the best examples of that. And in fact, because, you know, this idea, you know, that ordinary people are special, it runs through really this period of the show. It certainly runs in this episode, you know, later on, because what ends up happening is this has caused a huge effect, where you've got these monsters, and they're not called Reapers in the story. I think that maybe just be a retrospective description of the monsters, but you've got these Reapers who appear and just start devouring things.
And they just came out of nowhere. It's something we've never seen before, but to be fair, the Doctor does say at one point, my people would have stopped this from happening.
Mm-hmm.
But now these Reapers have come to kind of sterilise the wound in time.
Yeah.
I mean, at the time I thought, well, why aren't they... from Big Finish, there was Vortisaurs, which were essentially these pterodactyls that lived inside the vortex.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought, well, why didn't they just get the Vortisaurs in? That would have been cooler. But, instead we got these Reapers. And unfortunately, we'll never see them again. What's your take on how they look, how they were designed, and how photorealistic it is and believable it is?
I think they're a good design. How it's realised is another matter. And this isn't just a case that I think the CGI is dated. I remember at the time when I first watched it in 2005, I thought, oh, I didn't think... They didn't quite blend in. You could tell it was a CGI made thing. It didn't quite blend in. Although having said that, watching it now, I'm much more forgiving of it. You know, it is what it is, and it's I still think they're a good design. It was just maybe with the future release you would get the option to watch it with updated CGI and maybe just have it maybe better rendered. But I think they're fine. What do you think?
In retrospect, they don't look as bad as I remember. Mm-hmm. One technique that maybe made them look cheap to me at the time was that, you have to suspend your disbelief. The fact that in most cases the camera is locked off and still, and you have the CGI monster coming into the scene, whether that be in midair or attacking the front of the church. I'm very aware that, okay, this is a shot that's filmed. They've placed this image on top. Had the shots been felt more organic, if they were moving, which would have been more technical, maybe it would have blended better.
Oh, that's a good point, actually. Yeah, you're probably right. I think there's still effect, because originally we're seeing their point of view. How they look is held off a bit, and everything's red and blurred and scary looking.
And people are being picked off. We have like a homeless person disappears and just a bottle of cider.
I actually thought that was quite effective, actually. I quite liked that, but I think that the creepiest, the two really creepy moments, there's a bit when, there's children in a park.
One of them being Mickey.
One of them being a young version of Mickey, yeah. And they're all just... Well,
was Mickey going to the wedding? He was dressed in a suit, wasn't he?
He was dressed fairly smartly, but I don't think he was going to the wedding. He runs to the church because it's the nearest place of safety. Maybe they were, possibly, because wasn't the woman who was pushing him in the swing, wasn't she dressed, like, smartly? Maybe, I'm not sure, but... I thought the fact that all these children are getting picked off in a park and everyone's disappearing, and I thought that was quite effective. And then later on, we just see an abandoned car, and then just a child's shoe on a that was scary, and I thought very effective. And I like the idea that they're able to find sanctuary in a church because it's been there for an awful long time.
Yes, so, it's one thing that's kind of unchanged, because mm-hmm. these creatures have come to sterilize the changes in time. My perspective in the first half of the story was that they were picking off people from the wedding, because these people their day has now changed because Pete hasn't died. But then later on, Pete does speculate that maybe these things are all over the world. And I think that is the case when the doctor says, there's just a handful of people in the world left.
Yeah,
the Reapers are actually everywhere.
Yeah. Which gives the story a sense of grandeur a bit, but yeah. It wasn't necessary, because the threat's still in this local area, and the idea that you had, which was the focusing on people who would attend the wedding for the reason that you said, would make sense. That's great, but I just like the idea that you got this building, and it's rooted in time, because it's been there for quite some time. I quite like that idea. But going back to the earlier point, which is, ordinary people are important, it's when they're in the church and you've got the bride and the groom who are talking to the doctor, saying, can you save us? And they have this whole conversation. And the doctor finding out, well, how did you meet and all the rest of it, which is just really nice. And then the doctor says, he basically compares his life to theirs. And we think, I've been to these amazing places. I travel in time and space. But I've not had what you've had, which is just this, this wonderful developing relationship, and that's just wonderful. And I love that scene. It's just really, really nice. And there are loads of these wonderful emotional moments throughout this, you know, throughout the episode. There's a bit, you know, because the Doctor's really hacked off with Rose. For what she did, the problem that she's
yeah, they've had a bit of a fallout.
Yeah, yeah, they do, and you know, calling her just another stupid ape, and I mean, because that actually, because you know, he basically storms off and says, "Right, I'm just leaving you here," and she's like, "Yeah, yeah, he'll be back," and he'd be like, "Watch me, I'm off." Goes storming off to the TARDIS, realizes something wrong when he just opens the police box, and that's all it is. It's just the. It's hollow. It's literally a police box, which I thought was a very good scene. Very, very, again, very simple, but very effective. You know, it tells you that something's, you know, definitely up. But again, you know, so then he goes back to, you know, to Rose and telling her, you know, something's wrong. But they have this wonderful moment in the, you know, in the church when the Doctor's reprimanding her. She's getting emotional. And then he says, look, all what you need to say is you're sorry. And, she, you know, she says she's sorry. And she generally means it, and you know, they're back to being friends again, which is again just a nice emotional moment played real, and you know, you do get that sense, and both of the actors playing that very, very well.
Yeah.
No, sorry, go on.
And then it does turn into a bit of a partially Doctorless episode because. The Reapers do come in and the Doctor dies.
Yes, yeah, yeah.
Surprisingly.
gets eaten and that's it. And really, it comes down to Rose's father, Pete. He knows that... Because again, it's sort of, you know, he's not stupid and he's able to work out exactly what's going on. There's a bit of a comic moment because... Jackie, Rose's mother, thinks that the adult Rose is just someone that Pete's playing around with. Pete worked out that, you know, it is his daughter, and actually he should have died, and the fact that he didn't is causing all these problems. And there's just a comic moment of, you know, finally when Jackie, you know, is able to clock up. It's just like, think about it, woman. It's Rose, she travels in time, it's our, you know, and all the rest of it, which I quite like. So there's, even though I'm focusing on the emotion of the episode, there are some, you know, there is humour in there. And I think it's wonderfully balanced. So, you know, you got the threat of the Reapers and what's taking place and people have died and people have disappeared. You've got the emotion of the overall story and what's taking place, but you've also got humour balancing it all out. And I think it's very deftly handled.
Yeah, and that leads on to the emotional climax where, of course, Pete's realised what he needs to do.
Mm-hmm.
And he's kind of staring out the window at this car. And the car's just circling the church or keeps reappearing on the street. Is this kind of like the universe trying to compensate and put things back on track?
I think so, because it's like this car's just caught in a time loop because it was clearly meant to run Pete over, but the fact that it hasn't happened is what's causing the problem. So it's caught in a time loop, obviously waiting for the moment for Pete to do, quote, the right thing to right everything. There's a moment earlier on, just before this happens, where Rose is apologising. No, hang on, sorry. I think Pete apologises. Rose says, what you're apologising for, it's not your fault. And then he responds with, I'm your father, it's my job for it to be my fault. Or words to that effect, which I think is really rather nice. And apparently, those were words that Paul Cornell's father actually said to him when he was a child. So he's actually, you know, put in some... So, you know, it's, some of it's autobiographical in that respect.
That's interesting.
Yeah, yeah, so not only does Paul Cornell write a very good story, but, you know, he brings in, you know, personal aspects in it to help tell that story. And I remember when I... Because I didn't know that at the time when I first watched it, of course. And I remember that line always stood out to me, and I just thought it was a really nice line. And Paul Cornell... It turns out that Paul Cornell apparently just plucked that out, and, you know, from his own life and put it in, and, you know, that's quite powerful.
Yeah. I guess this is a story that resonates with everyone, whether you've had a father that was absent or not, in some ways. Rose and Pete do have a bit of a fake heart-to-heart at one point, where Rose is saying all the nice things that he used to do for her, take her on picnics and days out and things.
Yeah.
Creating this false illusion that, you know, he was there.
Yeah, but but he knows it's not
true. That doesn't sound like me.
Yeah, he said that's not me. Because, you know, she's telling the story, you know, you told her stories every night and you took us on picnics every Saturday. They're sort of, you know, overly romanticising it all and said, that's not me, that's not true. And then, of course, it leads up to the awful thing, which is, in order to put everything right, what was originally an accident of him accidentally being run over, he now has to, basically, he has to commit suicide.
Yeah, and he tells her what he needs to do.
Yeah.
He says, of course, the doctor figured it out a long time ago. Perhaps the doctor was just trying to save Rose, having to go through that whole scenario.
Yeah.
And Jackie gets pulled in on it too, like that moment you said when he says to Jackie, you know, this is our Rose, and she realizes. And then Pete brings up the fact that I didn't take you on all those picnics. I didn't read the stories for you, but this is time to make it right and put things back on track.
Mm-hmm. But one thing that he does say is that, you know, but some good did come out of this, which was that he was actually given, you know, a couple of more hours life and was able to meet, you know, his grown-up daughter. Which actually,
yeah, you know, who else gets that opportunity?
Yeah. And you know, so that was lovely. It, you know, it does put that positive spin on it, if you like. But again, so he's run over, he dies, but Rose is able to do the very thing that she wanted to do in the first place, which comfort him in his, you know, in his dying moments. And that does affect how Rose, as a young, you know, as a young child, was told the story. You know, it does have that effect.
Because originally he was alone.
Yes, he died alone. But now she's told the story that, you know, don't know who it was, but there was a young woman who, you know, held his hand in during his, you know, his final moments, so he didn't die alone.
Yeah. So things have changed, but I guess for the better now, yeah.
Yeah.
It was quite emotional. This whole story resonated with me a lot differently than it did back then, because my perspective back then was as a child, but now as a parent, I took it a whole different way. So it was a kind of emotional different ways, which is interesting. Different perspective.
Yeah, I mean, it's an episode that I always liked. I liked it when I first watched it in 2005. But as you said, we were pretty much still kids. We were what, 18 when it came out, if that,
yeah.
Maybe slightly younger, maybe 17 or something. You know, still kids, really. I liked it. But now, as you say, being older, it resonates far more strongly than it did back then. I mean, yeah. I got the emotional aspect of the story, but now it just carries more weight and it resonates far more strongly.
But yes, it's interesting that events have changed, and I'm guessing now Rose remembers the tale of her father differently, because Jackie did tell young Rose at the end of the episode. We saw a new version where, is that right?
Jackie tells her
that there was a girl that stayed with her,
and then we end with the Doctor and Rose hand in hand, just walking back to the TARDIS, and that we end, which I think was a nice ending. There was one thing which I didn't think was as good as it could have been. It's a slight moment. And it's actually Christopher Eccleston. And it's at the very beginning of the episode. Now, I'm really nitpicking here. but I couldn't help think it when I was watching the episode for the podcast. As we know, Christopher Eccleston is a very good actor. So I'm not disputing that. I'm not an idiot. But I think even, you know, even Christopher Eccleston acknowledges that, you know, he's best as an actor when he's being, you know, when it's the serious and the, you know, and it's grounded in, you know, something, I don't know, gritty, if you like. He perhaps finds it a little bit difficult playing lighter moments and play, you know. I think he perfects that, funnily enough, in his final two episodes. But up until that point, you know, when basically getting to the point is, you know, when Rose and the Doctor are in the TARDIS and they're traveling to 1987, Rose is apprehensive, but the Doctor's sort of trying to be supportive and he's trying to be supportive and he's just looking at it as another way of just another journey for the TARDIS, and he's trying to be upbeat.
Yeah.
It's the only time in this episode when I am aware that I am watching Christopher Eccleston acting. Everything else, it just, you know, because he's, you know, good acting is when it just appears natural, like breathing, and you don't think it. It's the only moment in the episode when he's trying to be light and trying to appear as, you know, it's not as serious as it is. As a counteract to Rose's reaction. It's the only moment in the episode when I'm aware that Christopher Eccleston's acting.
Interesting, yeah. I didn't pick up on that.
As I say, it's a fleeting moment. It's just, but I couldn't help thinking it when I was watching the episode. The rest of it is fantastic, but it's just, you know, it's just that one moment. Yeah. But as I said, it's I'm not saying it's awful.
Yeah.
I just think you're just kind of aware that even, I mean, actors are learning all the time. You hear it with very well-established actors like, you know, for example, Sir Ian McKellen. You know, he's talking about, you know, we look back at performances he did decades ago and you go, wow, that was fantastic. But then, he'd be interviewing, talking about those and going, yeah, I suppose, but if I was to play that part now, I would do it a completely different because I've learned a lot more in those, you know, in the years. It's, you know, acting's it's like anything in life. You're constantly learning how to improve and be better.
Yeah.
I
guess in that respect, it's a shame we didn't get more of Chris.
Yeah, very much so. I mean, look for example, Peter Davison. Again, you know, like Christopher Eccleston, you know, different actor, type of actor, of course, but still very good. And when he's playing the Doctor, you know, he hits the ground running. But compare, you know, and he was brilliant from the first moment he plays the Doctor to the very end. But look at how he plays the Doctor in his third and final year compared to the first two.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's a much stronger, much more confident performance. Yes.
Yeah. I think he himself has said, you know, I would have done that differently. I wish I'd said that differently about certain things.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and so even though I've pointed this moment out, I don't want to sound sort of like massively critical. It's just, you're just kind of aware of just going, there's just one moment of the episode where I'm just aware that it's not as strong as how he's performing in the rest of the episode. And you're just kind of aware that, you know, this is an actor learning something he hasn't done before.
Yeah.
He nails it in his final two episodes.
Mm.
You know, just everything's just pitched perfectly. And as you say, it's just one of those, it's a shame. I mean, we're getting him in Big Finish, which is fantastic now, but in terms of television, it's a shame
we didn't get
from that,
yeah.
Perspective. We don't get to see that. But
mm-hmm. Well, maybe Jodie Whittaker's next series will be like Peter Davison's in the third series. No, be optimistic.
No. Well, as I said, just going back to that original point, it's just my problem with what we're calling the Jodie Whittaker era. Funny, it's nothing to do with Jodie Whittaker. I think, you know, she's, you know, very good. I like her performance. She's made it her own. And she's done a good job. The problem that I have with it is I just feel that at present, she hasn't really been given the opportunity with the material given to really show off what she can do.
Yeah.
I think, you know, the problem that I have with it is really comes down to Chris Chibnall's approach to the show.
Yeah. Well, I guess we'll have a lot more to talk about soon as more news kind of trickles through. And we'll have to really get engaged for, like, changing more focus and reviewing those stories when they come out. we're going to have, 8 consecutive weeks of Jodie Whittaker stories.
Before we go on to listeners' responses and then wrapping everything up, is there anything that you want to mention that perhaps I haven't raised?
No, I think we've hit all the marks on that.
So we have had some listeners' responses, which is great. So just going to go through those. So on Twitter, Kimberly Taylor got in contact. Hang on, just hit my lamp. Kimberly Taylor got in contact and said, I have only watched Father's Day once when it first aired and skipped watching the episode ever since because it affected me. Not in a personal way, just because it was sad with Rose's dad dying. Overall, it was an interesting episode showing what will happen if time gets rewritten. It's interesting that she said that, you know, she's only watched it once, but clearly remembers it very well.
Yes. It had its impact.
Neither the time nor the space has said, on the whole, I really quite like this episode, but I'm disappointed the Reapers, if that is what they're called, never reappear after the Doctor messes with the timeline every other week from this point on. You made that point earlier, didn't you, Rob, as well?
Yes, I think it's hard not to consider the fact that maybe they could or probably would appear in other scenarios. Mm-hmm. Why is it just a one-off thing? And also, had they come back more recently, it would be interesting to see where the design of them kind of leads.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I quite like that they're on off and they're still memorable. But yeah, I think it's one of those monsters where it's like you can clearly see the potential of them coming back.
Yeah. Or maybe something similar. Why it doesn't necessarily have to be the Reapers. Why couldn't it be another another element or another creature? Something mm-hmm. trying to put things right. Yeah.
Yeah. Rob Keeley said, one of the absolute best from the modern era. I agree with that. Contains all the best bits from Paul Cornell's new adventures in a modern fable that everyone can understand. There's one more point he says, but just in terms of the Virgin New Adventures, because he wrote Time, Worm, Revelation, Love and War, Nor Future, Human Nature, which would later be adapted in Happy Endings. He's written loads more for Doctor Who, but in terms of New Adventures, those are the ones. And yeah, it... this does feel like it's a continuation of the best that the New Adventures had, which Paul Cornell had a big part in running. Writing. So yeah, I agree with Rob Keeley's point there, but he ends on this point as well. You know, when he's saying, you know, one of the best of the modern era. The Jodie series need more like this.
Yes, we've had emotional stories in the new era, one being the one about Ryan's dad, resolution. Not the same at all. It was just that he could have lost his dad, but then he didn't. It wasn't the same at all. Yeah, but yeah, the new era does need better stories.
It does. And the thing is, there has been an attempt of trying to get some emotional resonance going on with the Jodie Whittaker stories, but it doesn't hold up. It doesn't quite work.
Yeah.
And it's like what we said, the way that when Ryan and... what's his grandfather's character called?
Graham.
Graham, yes, thank you. When those two characters leave in that last episode, and then we're seeing them carrying on from how they were in the very first episode of which they were introduced, it's just so... Are we supposed to be impressed with this sort of cylindrical thing? It's like it's what a teenager would write.
Mm-hmm.
And actually, if anything, it emphasises how there's been no major progression.
No, it feels a bit unfulfilled.
it's just, I'm sorry, but you know, there's no emotional intelligence or weight to any of it. The attempt is there, but it doesn't work. In of itself, you can clearly see it and criticize for what it is. But then when you're presented with stories like Father's Day, it emphasizes it even more. Like, here's a story which gets it right, knows what it's doing. And it's fantastic because Father's Day, I think, works as a story. You know, you can watch it as an individual story. You get it from, you can watch it as a self-contained story, and it's, you know, and you get it. But it also works in the structure of the, you know, the series between, you know, Rose as a character, the Doctor as a character, the relationship between those two.
Yeah.
And then, because you picked up on this point later on, you know, Rose then, because of the events of this story, has a moment with her own mother about it. You know, so it you know, you can watch it and enjoy it and emotionally connect in of itself, but you can also see how it's important and how it threads through the series as a whole. You know, that's really good.
Yeah.
That's good writing. That's what's engaging, and this is what makes something like Father's Day. I mean, because we had a listener, you know, I read her response just a few moments ago. She said she only watched this episode once, but she remembers it. And, you know, and she remembers it because of that emotional connection. That's powerful viewing.
Yeah. And that was, what, 15, 20 years ago?
Yeah. That's, you know... that's something which has an impact, and you know, as you say, that, you know, that's a long time ago.
Yeah,
we're not going to be people may in the future reevaluate the Jodie Whittaker era and go, you know what, it wasn't as bad, whatever, that may happen.
But yes, but like you said, Father's Day had an impact on the characterization and the series itself. When we look at some of the hallmarks of Jodie Whittaker's first series, maybe Rosa. Could be looked at as a talking point. It's emotional, it's important, but this is being forced upon you narrative wise. I'm not saying it's a bad story or anything, but then there's bits of the story that are impactful on Ryan and Yasmin. The racial
stuff, again, is not really picked up on.
It's not
afterwards.
At all. It feels important, but it isn't part of their whole characterization as a whole.
No, and that's what I was going to say. The Jodie Whittaker era in the future may be reevaluating. Go, you know what? It wasn't as bad as it was, but I don't think people would reevaluate in terms of the emotional connection because it is. It's just not there. It's just not there.
Yeah.
And
if any of these characters were to come back with the future Doctor, even for a one-off, I'd probably feel even more of a disconnect.
Mm-hmm. And this is the thing as well. When the show came back in 2005, one of the things that it was always praised for was the fact that it was more emotional. And that was something that I got right compared to the classic series. But I think that again, that conversation was overplayed. It was this idea that classic Doctor Who was never emotional. I disagree with that completely.
I can probably think of a handful of moments.
Well, the thing is, I think what people forget is that Britain in the 60s and the 70s, for example, is completely different to the Britain of when we grew up. You know, people made this... When Princess Diana died, for example, in 1997, the emotional outpouring in this country was way off the scale. You know, and compare that to when Winston Churchill died, early 65, if I've got the year right. 65, 66? I think it was 65. And he had a state funeral, and, you know, he was a big, important public figure. In a different way, but as Princess Diana was, and look at the way that the country reacted to his day. You know, country was completely different. So remember that. But nonetheless, you know, for example, when Susan leaves,
yeah,
that whole speech that the Doctor gives, you know, one day I will come back. That whole speech leading up to that moment, and that moment, that's emotional.
It's memorable. Well, I think we all know that word for word.
Yeah. I mean, I could quite. I'm not going to. But yeah, you could look at when Ian and Barbara leave. The doctor takes that really bad. That's emotional. Look at when Zoe and Jamie leave. Look at when Joe Grant and Sarah Jane leave. Yes, later on there are a couple of, like the way that Leela leaves isn't particularly.
We have Adric. It wasn't a departure. It was a death. But that.
Yeah, but obviously you know that. You know, that has, no pun intended, that had an impact. So, the show... That pun was intended, despite what I said it was. But, you know, so... The classic Doctor Who had these emotional moments, and we remember them. New Doctor Who, same thing. Jodie Whittaker's era... It attempts to do it. It just doesn't. It doesn't work. And as I said, you can see that in of itself. But when you get episodes like Father's Day, it really emphasises it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But yeah, the characters don't change, apart from the fact that they become more accustomed to travelling with the Doctor.
Mm-hmm.
There's not much when you compare early Ryan, Graham, and Yasmin to later Ryan, Graham, and Yasmin. There's not much difference. Even when they spend a lot of time on Earth with that new TARDIS where they're waiting for the Doctor, they've still got each other. So it's not like they've been through some tremendous loss and they've changed so much.
I feel like I went through a mini rant there. But anyway, we've got some other listeners' responses, haven't we?
Yes, Tony Filer said, a thing of surprise and beauty, which helped redefine the kind of stories New Who could tell. Great monster, impressively sci-fi story, but absolutely rooted in an emotional moment. Fabulous. Kristen said, it's actually one of my favourite episodes. It's massively underrated. In my opinion, it showed how human Rose was compared to the Doctor. I myself know I couldn't watch my dad die and not do anything about it, even if I said to myself I wouldn't. It wasn't a very bittersweet ending. It was a very bittersweet ending and was a great debut for Pete.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I agree with all that. I think it's a very good summary.
Yeah, another example of how this story just kind of resonated with us in personal ways.
Mm-hmm.
But that was it for Instagram.
Oh, great. Thanks, Rob. Also put a poll up asking what people thought in terms of the ranking, so good, average, or bad. So 8% thought it was bad. Oh, these people.
Heartless. 12%,
heartless, cold people. 12% thought it was average, a little bit more empathetic, but could do better. Whereas 80% marvellous people thought it was good.
That's good. Brilliant. Yep, I couldn't agree more. I'd say, of course, it's a fantastic episode. In fact, I wouldn't even say it's an underrated episode, to be honest.
No, I mean, I can get why people may think that, because when you...
It's not a commonly referenced one.
No, it's not. But I think it's quite clear that it's an episode that is much beloved and people certainly remember it.
Hmm.
You know, I certainly do, and yeah. So in terms of your conclusions and score?
Yep, of course. I would rate it good, top marks. It's one that we can all relate to in certain ways. Definitely resonated with me a lot differently now being a parent myself. So there's a lot to take away from that. The technicality of the time travel, the paradox or whatever, it's all very understandable, especially with the Reapers, the whole thing of the car appearing and disappearing outside. It's very technical, but it's very simple at the same time. Very good story, very good writing, great performances all around.
Yeah, I totally agree with that. I think that's a very good summing up. I think it's a superb episode. You know, the emotional resonance, basically everything we've talked about and everything you've said, totally agree. And yeah, I would, I think it's perfectly clear. I score it good as well.
Fantastic.
You know, fantastic. You know, I love this episode. I could, you know, I could easily rewatch it. I think, you know, because it can put you through the emotional ringer a little bit. Certainly in terms of a Doctor Who. So maybe you would want a bit of a palate cleanser in between, you know, watch something a bit more lighthearted before you come back to it. But certainly an episode I will more than happily rewatch. You know, it's yeah, it's fantastic.
Yeah. So is that it for Father's Day this week?
Yep.
All areas covered. Next week we're gonna go on to our favourite David Tennant stories, our favourite 10th Doctor stories. So next week it's my turn to choose. I've put a lot of thought into it. A lot of contenders, but I'm going with The Girl in the Fireplace.
Oh, right. Good choice, Rob. Nice one. Okay, look forward to talking about that one.
Yeah. Which is, of course, a Series 2 episode featuring Rose again. So that'll be a good chat.
Yeah, good choice. Looking forward to that one. Obviously, we'll hold off on what my favourite David Tennant one is. I think it'll take people by surprise, but we'll talk about that later on. But yes, The Girl in the Fireplace, very good choice.
Well,
Sorry,
go ahead. You do it.
No, that's fine. Just that awkward moment of trying to end a conversation there. So that's it for this podcast. Thank you very much for listening. And... and thank you for taking part in the conversation, Rob. It's been good. So until next week, when as Rob said, we will be talking about the Girl in the Fireplace. Bye, everyone.
Thanks. Bye.